Hello, welcome to Rational Investing. My name is Cameron Stewart, CFA. Thank you very much for watching the channel, all the comments and subscribers. I greatly appreciate it. Thank you very much. If you're watching this video for the first time, this is the channel that's dedicated to the rational investor, the investor that's hungry for free cash flow and likes to buy that free cash flow cheaply and hold it for a long time. Here we look at stocks, we peer through their 10Ks, we figure out what they're actually worth, what they're generating, and if we can get them in a steal and make good money over a long time, that's our objective. This week up, Texas Instruments, the giant domestic semiconductor manufacturing company that is out there and trading. Let's take a look at their recent 10K filed as of December 2020, figure out what the business is producing in free cash flow, what we think it's gonna do in the future based on current economic climate and what they've done historically to figure what a fair price to pay for the stock is. Then, once we have the fair price, we'll compare it to the market and we'll figure out what the return is that we could hold. Ready? Let's get to work. The first thing we need to do before we dive into Texas Instruments is to look at the five key attributes that we use to judge all of our investments. And those are gonna be top line revenue growth, you gotta have it. Earnings growth, we look at enterprise level EBITDA earnings, gotta be growing. Free cash flow, I want strong, growing free cash flow. Low debt, that's less than 3x debt to EBITDA, and a well-priced stock. We use enterprise value to EBITDA to judge well-priced. We also use free cash flow yield. Ultimately, that well-priced stock needs to produce a return that's greater than the market for us to be judged well-priced. That's what we use, enterprise value to EBITDA. Okay, let's rip through this 10K. Now, I highly suggest that you print this out and read it along with me. It's an excellent, excellent read by a very, very good management team and is a staple of how to write a 10K. I really liked what I read, and I'm gonna walk through a couple key aspects that I really enjoyed. Here we go. The first couple pages of a 10K or an annual report is typically a letter from the chairman, CEO, or president. In this case, we have a letter from Rich Templeton, who is all three, the chairman, president, and CEO of Texas Instruments, kind of a trifecta there. That's quite the title, chairman, president, and CEO. But read his letter. It outlines their strategy. It outlines their philosophy, and I always like starting there. Here, excellent, excellent letter. There's things here that I really liked. For example, we act like owners who will own the company for decades. I like seeing a management company that is invested in owning the shares and says it right there. Our strategy is to maximize free cash flow per share growth rate. It's right in there in black and white. And then they look for the most efficient use of every dollar that they spend. A couple other things that I really liked. We will remain focused on the belief that long-term growth of free cash flow per share is the ultimate measure to generate value. Beautiful. You can count on us to stay true to our ambitions, to think like owners for the long term, adapt and succeed in a world that is ever changing, and behave in a way that makes the shareholders proud. I like that. It's a great way to kind of set the stage for what's to come. Check out his letter. Moving forward, you get into section one, was typically a business summary, and you read right here, it tells you exactly what the company does. Very first sentence, we design and make semiconductors that we sell to electronic designers and manufacturers all over the world. We generated $14.46 billion of revenue. I also like, we act like owners. So they're continuing to hammer that message of, hey, we're in this, we own this along with you, that's good. They talk about their strategy. The first couple page, our strategy. They've got a couple components here. One, be strong foundation for manufacturing and technology. Two, a broad portfolio of analog and embedded processing products. Three, a reach of our market channel. And four, the diversity of longevity of our products, markets, and customers. That is their moat that they're describing, and I believe it. You keep going down to the next page, and they're talking about the number of customers they have. Here, 80,000 customers. This broad portfolio includes approximately 80,000 products, excuse me, not customers, products that are integral in almost every type of electronic equipment. Fantastic. The types of products that they make analog products, and they make embedded processing semiconductors. So, analog is the biggest sector, about $11 billion. Basically, real-world signals. What does that mean? That's like sound, temperature, pressure, image, devices that take those inputs and convert them into a digital stream of data. And they're embedded in all kinds of products throughout the world. This is 75% of their revenue. The next big segment of their revenue is the embedded processing, right? So embedded processing, that's about $2.5, $2.6 billion of their 2020 revenue. And embedded processing products are digital brains, right? That measure specific variables and optimize for performance. And what I particularly liked is this sentence down at the bottom here about their customers invest a lot of R&D writing software that run the devices that these guys make. So once they produce a device for a customer and the customer has written software that runs that device, the customer is very unwilling to change manufacturers because the custom software goes to the product that they produce. Very good, sticky kind of products. I like to see that. Next page, again, running through the 10K. This is what you would be doing if you read this, kind of a quick glance, the first couple pages, you get a real sense of the business. A breakdown of their industries that they focus in. A lot of industrial, but then you have automotive, personal electronics, communication equipment. There's a lot here. And a lot of diversity, which I really like. The last section I want to get to is the number of customers they have. They state down at the bottom here, number of customers is 100,000 customers. That's a huge diverse base. They said with more than a third of the revenue derived from the largest 100. So 100 customers make up one third of their revenue. The rest is two thirds. That is significant customer diversification, which I really, really like. It then goes on in greater detail. They have a lot of manufacturing facilities around the world. They outline those facilities. They talk about the competitive landscape. It is very competitive. And they talk about the semiconductor cycle, which tends to be long upswings and downswings of short supply, high demand, a high supply, low demand. And right now we're in the short supply, high demand phase. Last thing, let's take a look at their cash flow statement and then we'll go take a look at the long-term trend and make a forecast. Okay, behind me is their cash flow statement. I'm on page 33 of the PDF, page 27 of the actual 10K if you're with us. So what you got here is the cash flow statement. Cash flow statements always begin with the net income statement. It's basically taking the P&L, the income statement, which starts with revenue to net income. The cash flow statement fits in underneath the income statement and goes from net income to free cash or cash balance on the balance sheet. So here we go, net income, $5.6 billion, relatively flat over the last 3 years. Big number, positive number, flat number. 5.58, 5.0, 5.59. So that gives us some sense of what the business is doing right away. The next thing I look at is the free cash flow from operations. This line up here, 7.2, 6.6, and $6.1 billion. Again, positive, flat number. I want to take a look at the CapEx. CapEx is the amount of money that they put back into their manufacturing setups to continue them running, continue making the semiconductors. And it's relatively small relative to the cash flow from operations, which is a good news. It means that every year they sell their semiconductors. Cash from customers comes in the door. They pay their employees, they pay their rent, they pay their insurance, they pay management, bonuses, all that stuff is done. And at the end of the year, they have $6.1 billion of jack sitting in the bank account. Then management gets together and says, okay, gentlemen, ladies and gentlemen, what do we do with this cash going forward? Well, we have to invest some of it for next year's to protect the assets that we already have. Paint the walls, buy new computers, install IT systems, that's all in here. Then they can pay debt, then they can pay dividends, then they can buy back shares, then they can make acquisitions. And what you see down below is exactly how they do that. So this money here means that they only put about 10% of the free cash back in the business, which leaves a lot of cash to go do what they need to do, which is something I like to see. That's a strong signal of free cash flow. Good job. When I go down the P&L, the free cash flow statement, I get to the financing section down below. This is where you're gonna see share buybacks, dividends, and debt payments. And what you're gonna notice, proceeds from the issuance of long-term debt, $1.5 billion, $1.5 billion, $1.5 billion. Like clockwork, they are issuing a large amount of debt. We'll see if they can afford it in a second, but that's a big number. Payments on debt, repayment debt, $500 million, $750 million, $500 million. So right away, you can see that they're issuing about $1 billion a year in more debt than they're paying down, right? 1.5, negative 5. 1.5, negative 750. 1.5, negative 5. So that's about $1 billion every year of higher debt that they're doing. Fine, we'll figure out if they can pay for it. Below that, dividends paid and share repurchasing. So dividends, they're kicking out $2.5 billion, $3 billion, $3.5 billion. So they're moving a lot of money out the door. That's a lot of jack that's going out the door for the total dividend payment. This isn't per share, this is everything. And that's roughly 50% of the free cash flow from operations. So if you look at cash flow from operations all the way up to 6.1, all the way up here, and you look at how much money they're kicking out just for dividend, that's about 50% of the total cash that's given out. Now, they had to pay for CapEx, which is not that big of a deal, they can afford that. And then the rest of the cash, they use to buy back shares. The share repurchases, $5.1 billion. That is almost all the cash flow from operations they made in 2019. Next year, $3 billion, next one, $2.5 billion. So that's coming down a little bit as they're buying shares. But they are, what are they doing? They're taking $2.5 billion, they're going to the public market, they're buying their own stock, and they tear the shares up and destroy them. And what that means is the shares that are left out in the market now own a greater percentage of the business. And it's something that we look for and we want to see in this channel. A company that produces free cash flow, buys back their own shares, that's a good thing. So when I add these two up, and I'll typically do this regularly for any company I look for, not just the dividend, for those of you that look at dividend yield, you should really switch and look to a yield of both dividend and share buyback. If I add these numbers up and divide this by the market cap or the enterprise value, that is a much better, truer dividend yield, if you will, because it's including both share buyback and the actual dividend. And this is about $6 billion each year, $6 billion, $6 billion, and $7 billion, which if you notice up here, $7 billion, $6 billion, $6 billion. So they're paying out almost 100% of their free cash flow from operations as a dividend and a share buyback. That is a little concerning to me. I would like to see a little less than that, but they have the cash. CapEx is relatively low. They're borrowing a little bit of money, so we'll see if they can sustain that borrowing. But other than that, I'm liking what I'm seeing here. It's pretty clean, large positive numbers. They're buying back shares and they're paying a dividend. Okay, now let's go take a look at the income statement and we'll look at our model and see what we think we're willing to pay for this business. Okay, behind me is 9 years of historical financial information from Texas Instruments. And if you remember at the outset when I said that the semiconductor industry has a long super cycles, right? Long upswings of high demand, low supply, and then the reverse of that, high supply, low demand. So what you're gonna see here is kind of the same thing. Revenue has grown over time, 12.1 to 14.4 billion, but revenue peaked here in 2018 at $15.7 billion. It's come down the last couple years, a little slight growth here. But overall, growth is about 2% a year. So it's not a rocket ship in terms of revenue growth. It is able to grow it. There's a little bit of a pullback, but technically this does meet our mark, right? We look for a business that can grow top line revenue growth. It's not double digits, which we would like to see, but it's a single digit. It is growing, so I'd expect a lower multiple for this because the growth is a little weaker, so I would expect to pay a little less than this than say an Amazon or a Google or something that's growing at a strong double digit. Let's look at our measure for profitability, enterprise level earnings or EBITDA. Same thing here, 3.6 billion has grown to 6.6 billion, actually strong growth. 8% annual growth, which is a good number. I really like to see that. It's higher than revenue, which means margins are expanding. If earnings are growing faster than revenue, then profit margins are expanding, which means that they're doing better and better at what they do. I like that. So I think that both checks the box there in revenue and earnings growth. Let's go look at enterprise value and see what this business is truly worth. We're going to start with the debt. This is short-term, long-term, and capital leases that they have, $5.6 billion to $7 billion. And you'll notice that this is growing over time, 3% a year, slightly higher than revenue, but less than earnings growth, so that's fine. And what I pointed out earlier in the cash flow statement with about $1 billion a year of growth, you can see 5, 6, 7. That is $1 billion a year of extra debt. This is this is total debt now versus before is cash flow. But total debt 5, 6, 7, the rate of change there is about $1 billion a year, which is what we saw in the cash flow statement. So it's basically $5.6 to $7 billion over time. Excess cash, they do have excess cash on their balance sheet. Good for them. And I've been pulling that from the short-term investments line. So what we're going to do now is look at market cap. Market cap has grown dramatically, actually, from $35 billion to $151 billion over time. This is shares outstanding times average price for the year, and I get a market cap. When I add the debt minus the free cash, the excess cash, plus the market cap, I get enterprise value. Enterprise value is the true value of the entire business, not EPS, but the entire business. $38 billion to $155 billion over time, which is strong, strong growth. So now, and I want to show you, the enterprise value is growing at 20%, 19% a year is the growth rate. Now, if you remember, revenue was growing at 2%, and EBITDA, earnings, was growing at 8% a year. But enterprise value is growing at 19% a year. So what I'm guessing from that is that our market multiple is expanding because the enterprise is growing faster than earnings. And when I look at the enterprise value, you can see just that. It started at 10 times earnings, a fair price for a company that's growing at 2% a year top line revenue. And it has expanded to 23 times over these 9-year period of time. So that, what does that mean? Right, this is a payback period. If I take the value, the price of something, and divide it by what it makes, its earnings, that is a payback period. Meaning if I bought the business 9 years ago and I paid 10 times, let's just go look at the math, it was generating $3.6 billion of earnings. I could have bought that business for $38 billion. That's 10 times, meaning the business will generate earnings over 10 years that will equal the value it was when I bought it, which is great. And over this time frame, it has done just that as earnings have slowly grown. But now as you go in time, now we're saying, hey, I got a business that generates 6.6 times profit each year, and I'm gonna pay now a much higher price for that, $155 billion. That's 23 times, that's a 23-year payback. That is a significant more risk into the future that you are putting your hard-earned dollars into when you sign up and buy the company at this value. And you've essentially more than doubled the price, the cost of every dollar that this business generates. Investors are now willing to pay twice as much for it today than they were just only a few years back, which is alarming to me because these tend to revert back to the average, right? So if this were to go back, you've got 1 year here of a plus 20 times, the rest of this almost decade is sub this number. So if it were to revert back down, that would be a massive price reduction, right? If I had to cut this price in half to get back to this number, you'd be halving the price of the stock right now. So I think when I look at risk reward as an investor, I want a business that meets all five criteria, right? But I want a company that if the market downturn happens, the price downside is less than the upside. That's what the classic investors who have succeeded dramatically in their careers have done. They've been able to judge the downside risk with the upside. And if I'm looking at a business that is growing earnings at 8%, but has a downside risk of perhaps 50%, because this is going from 23 times back to 10, that's a risk reward that's gonna make me pause, and you're gonna see that in a little while. Let's finish the sheet. Debt, net debt, that's our risk of bankruptcy, right? We don't want a company that's got too much leverage. And when I take total debt, less excess cash, net these two to pay them off, and I look at that debt relative to the earnings that generate to pay off the debt, that is my EBITDA here. So I'll rephrase that one more time. Total debt, less cash, right? Net these two, this 2.5, this is 5.5, that's what, $3 billion. I say, okay, I have $3 billion of what they owe the bank. How much cash do they generate, or how much earnings do they generate every year? Well, they generate 3.6, slightly more than one times, slightly less than one. So that means it will take me less than 1 year if I had to pay off all debt to pay the debt off that the company has. That's great. That means I'm protected as an equity investor, that there's less people, less institutions, less banks in front of me. Should the business tank, because it's cyclical, should the business tank, and there's a risk of bankruptcy, there are fewer creditors ahead of my investment. So that's protection. I like that. That is a very good position. 0.5 times debt to EBITDA. Excellent. Good job, CFO of Texas Instrument. Okay, so this is revenue, earnings, EBITDA, market multiple. We've got a little bit of lesson here. We want to check on that value drop. That risk reward might not be there. Let's go look at free cash flow. Okay, behind me is 9 years of free cash flow. We're gonna start with the free cash flow from operations. That's what you saw before, CFO's free cash flow from operations. And it's gonna be $3.4 billion to grow to $6.1 billion. That growth rate is 8%, which is in line with EBITDA, which is our accounting smell check. It means that the income statement growth is following the cash flow statement growth, which means the accounting department is doing a great job. Kudos, accounting department, for expensing the right cost. They're not burying things, as far as we can tell. You know, you never know, but as far as we can tell, this is a great smell check. Cash flow statement lining up with earnings statement, you wanna see that. CapEx, we covered this early. It's relatively small relative to the cash flow of operations. So if in the end of the year, they generate this much free cash, actual hard cash that's in the bank account, right? And you can audit this. This is very easy. Auditors will look at the cash statement from JP Morgan or Wells Fargo, wherever these guys bank. They will look at that statement and they'll measure how much sales they had, and it's easy for the auditors to tie. Income earnings is a little bit more difficult because there's lots of things that the CFOs can do, but a cash statement from a third party like a bank is very easy for auditors to check. This isn't cash balance, obviously, this is just cash flow, but the principle is the same. Focusing on cash is very much harder for companies to hide hard cash. So, $6.1 billion, they put back 10% into the business, which is great. So this is strong free cash flow in my book. Debt payments, so debt payment here, they're paying down debt. Here they're growing debt, we covered this earlier. Nothing here is too high, they have very little debt, I'm fine with that. Free cash flow to equity. Free cash flow to equity, this is the cash money that the business is truly based on. And it's large, it's growing 10% a year, in line with CFO, in line with earnings. Great job, Texas Instrument. Kudos, guys. I like to see that. Now the fun part. Now remember that they were paying a dividend and they were buying back stock, and they were buying back a massive amount of stock. And you can see that here in shares outstanding. I'm pulling this right from the income statement from the 10K. Diluted shares outstanding, 1.1 billion shares down to 933 million. This is a reduction annually of 3% a year, and that is fantastic. That means if you bought the stock 10 years ago, you didn't put a dime into the business again, but your ownership stake of a growing business has increased. So there were, say, a billion other people that also own the business with you. Well, the business has grown over this period of time. Now there's only 900 million people that own the business with you. So your stake has grown and you don't have to put a dime into the business. I love to see that. Great job. When I take free cash flow divided by shares, I get free cash flow per share. This is growing strongly as well, obviously because they're chewing up shares at an alarming rate. And even if this was flat, they would still be growing because they're reducing the denominator here, which is nice. And then you get price per share, average price, and I get free cash flow yield. And here, this is reflecting the same thing we saw with the market multiple. A high yield previously when the business was relatively unloved almost a year ago, that is a strong, strong yield. 8% is a big yield for such a strong, stable company, and would have been a screaming buy back then. You would have held it. You're making 8-9% on your money in a world of 1-2%. Interest rates with a company that has almost zero debt and growing earnings. That is a phenomenal business to pick up. Fast forward 9 years, now it's paying me 4% a year. It has at a much higher rate. That's a much lower yield, right? So there's greater risk there that this yield or this price, 162, will revert back down. Not all the way, obviously, but will come back down. And this yield, 4.3, which is low, will move back up to its average 5.8%. And moving up in yield is a reduction of price. And again, that's showing us that there's a downside risk here to the price. Okay, let's try something different. Before we move on to the forecast, I wanna show you an example of EPS growth versus EBITDA and why we at this channel focus on enterprise level earnings and why it's so critical for you to read the 10K and focus on either EBITDA or operating income would be another alternative. Behind me is EPS, earnings per share. This is net income divided by shares outstanding. I've used fully diluted shares outstanding, but you get the idea. So EPS, earnings per share, is often what the street will talk about in an earnings release or a press release for a business. They'll say top line, revenue grew at X, and they'll do earnings grew at Y. The earnings they're generally referencing is EPS, not even net income, generally earnings per share EPS. We focus on the enterprise level EBITDA whole earnings, and I'll show you why right now. EPS has grown substantially over the last decade. When I look at the growth rate of EPS here, average, really tall number, right? 20% on average clip for earnings per share, net income divided by fully diluted shares. Fine. My EBITDA up above, that I showed you, was 8% a year. Well, this is the annual growth rate of EBITDA, 8% a year. What's the difference between these two? Well, the difference is substantially higher growth. So if you measure a company based on earnings per share, you're going to show, at least this company, is going to show 12% more growth on an annual basis than the business is truly growing on its own. What does this mean? Well, first of all, why is it happening? One, they're taking a lot of the free cash flow, they're buying back stock. That stock is canceling the number of shares outstanding, which is taking relatively weak earnings growth, its growth, but relatively weak earnings growth, dividing it by a smaller number, which is boosting the growth rate. That's what you're seeing here, which is fine, totally legitimate, but you don't want to pay too much for that growth because this growth here is manipulated by the shares outstanding. It is not true organic growth from customer demand, from a growing market landscape, from a phenomenal product. There are two different ways to grow a business, and that growth is worth two different numbers, right? If you're buying a business that has insatiable demand from customers and they're growing 20% every year, enterprise level profit, EBITDA, that is truly worth a high market multiple. If you have a business that's growing 20% a year EPS growth because the majority of the growth is coming from borrowing money, buying shares, and canceling shares, that's a different growth that's worth less, in my opinion. I would much rather pay for 20 times EBITDA here for a business that's growing 20% naturally without buying back shares than paying 20 times EBITDA for a business that is using its cash flow to cancel shares to offset what is relatively average, weak growth at the enterprise level earnings. And so what that is this is a lesson in what you're paying for, what type of growth. When you hear the street, earnings has grown at X, they're typically referring to this number, which can be manipulated by the number of shares outstanding. You need to dig through the detail, read this, which nobody does, and find out what the true business is growing at, because that's what you're buying. The true underlying business, you're not buying EPS growth. Now, I'll get off my horse on that, but that's a good one. The next thing I wanted to show you here before I go to the forecast, last, very quick, is we're currently yielding about 3% of free cash flow. So if I take free cash flow less CapEx, forget debt for a second, this is how much money they're paying every year in dividend and in share buyback, right? About $6 billion, about 100% of free cash flow to operations. The current market enterprise value of the business is $180 billion. If I divide these two, I get 3% yield. That means the business is yielding free cash flow that can be used to buy back shares or dividend is 3% number. Well, that historically was a lot higher, right? It was historically 8%, 5, 6, 8%. So the question is, if I need this 3% to revert back to a 5 or a 6% number, back to historic, what does the price per share have to do to go back to average? And that number is surprising, right? So if I put that number at $110 a share, that puts the yield back in the 6% range, which is more in line for a business that isn't growing very much. That's a massive drop. That's an $80 price drop, about a 50% drop in the stock price. So I think that is kind of the risk here when I look at what the downside potential of the stock is. Now, let's forecast and see what the upside potential of the business is. So the first thing we're gonna do on our forecast, like we always do, is we're gonna pick up the EBITDA. I'm gonna grow it at 7.8%, which is the 8% number that I've been seeing before. Last year's EBITDA times 8%, string it forward, I get $14 billion long-term of a long-term EBITDA forecast. I'm applying an average market multiple to this. Again, I expect that market multiple to come back down over time because it's a rarity. I'm not willing to pay, assume that the 20, which happened, the 23 times EBITDA happened once in a decade, I'm gonna bring that back down to 14.4 times, which is the average. Maybe it's 16, maybe it's, but 14.4. I subtract some cash, I subtract some debt, add some cash, I get a market cap, $215 billion, less fully diluted shares outstanding, or divide these two, and I get a $231 price target based on an EBITDA market multiple method. If I do the free cash flow, so here, free cash flow per share, $5.88. I'm taking free cash flow per share, free cash flow from operations, less CapEx, dividing by shares outstanding. I'm not pulling in the cash that they were borrowing. I'm just using pure cash flow, 8% a year, just like the EBITDA number. I get $11.56. I give it an average 5.8% free cash flow yield, and I get basically a $200 price, $199.98 stock price based on a free cash flow method. Now, if we combine these two, I've got two different prices, $199 and $231 off of two different valuation approaches. I'm gonna average the two at 215. I look at the out in the market right now, I can buy as much stock as I want at 190 a share. If I put this into an IRR model where I'm distributing all the free cash flow that they make, dividends, share buyback, it all goes out. I buy the stock at 190 a share, I sell at 215. This is my cash flow share. This is my free cash flow that I generate over the time, and it's a 6% IRR investment, which is wildly, wildly under market, and I think reflects overall a very, very robust stock market that we are currently seeing. And in my opinion, if I'm looking at a 10-year hold, which is what you should be looking for if you're an equity investor long-term, even if you don't hold it that long, you should believe that you could be stuck in the investment for a long time. Things happen, you get stuck in. So if long-term, I can make 6%, but as you saw earlier, the stock could fall $80 a share if it reverts back to its average for some reason. That is too much downside for me. It's trading 6% upside for a 50% downside. That's not what I like. I like the inverse. I want something that is very low downside and very high upside. That is something that a risk reward investment would do. For me, I'd need this number to be much, much higher in the 20s to be able to justify taking cash that is in other investments that's a plus 20% IRR and moving into this one, right? We only have so much cash, so it's prioritization. I'm a huge pass in this one. I'm gonna give it a bad investment. That's the rating here at this channel. Let's recap our five key attributes. One, top line revenue growth. Yes, it's growing. Two, EBITDA, strong earnings growth. It's growing. Three, strong cash flow. Yes, it's there. Four, low debt. Yes, it's there. Five, well priced. No, it is not. It is too expensive. It is a result of a robust stock market that we are seeing, and the risk return for me isn't there. Based on history, we've seen that the stock can trade a whole lot lower, has been valued at a whole lot less. I like the company. I would want to own this company, but I would want to own it for dramatically less. Okay, like we always do at the end of the videos, I want to show you a distribution chart. So here we are, $190 a share, current price, 6% IRR with the assumptions that I just walked through. The price goes up, obviously return goes down because you're paying more for a fixed set of assumptions. If the price falls, like we were talking about, what kind of return do you get? Well, back down below 139, you start getting above double digit. My number that I had was $110. So I would not be buying this stock until it's dramatically less than $140 a share, because even an 11% return, that's market, right? That's a market return. The S&P 500 will do about 10%. This stock is in the S&P 500. So if you buy that index, you are automatically buying the stock, which is overvalued. My suggestion, learn to read the 10Ks. Go read this one for yourself. Learn to read the 10Ks. Walk through a model yourself. Find the 10 to 20 stocks that truly meet your criteria and own just those and love those companies and own them for a long time. And you will be more satisfied as an investor than buying an index and automatically picking up some of this stuff which is overpriced. Now, if you want to learn how to do that, I do teach a course. Cashflowinvestingpro.com is where you can find the course. I give you this Excel model. I walk you through how to read a 10K, how to fill in all the numbers, how to think about forecasting, how to get an IRR, and how to build a focused portfolio that you can hold for over a decade to help you get where you want to go financially. My name is Cameron Stewart. This has been Rational Investing. We look through for free cash flow. We love to buy free cash flow yielding companies at a reasonable price. Texas Instrument, as much as I love the company, as much as it checked all four boxes, it did not check the well price. I'm going to wait. I'm going to put on my shelf $100 on this 10K. I'll stick it on the shelf. And when the stock does, if it ever does hit $100, I will re-examine it. Until then, there are so many other amazing investments out there that my cash is going to go elsewhere. Thank you very much. This is Cameron Stewart from Rational Investing. Please don't forget to subscribe, hit the like button, and throw down in the comment what you'd like to see next. There's a lot of value investors in those comments going absolutely bananas. I love the comments. I love the critiques. Fantastic. Let's keep it going. We're doing a great job. Thank you very much. I really appreciate the time. Take care. Bye-bye.